Okay, first of all, thank you for coming. It's a pleasure to address you guys here in Bahrain and this beautiful center. So thank you so much for having me here. I'm very happy to, yeah, it's working better. I'm very happy to be able to show you some of my work. I've been going around Bahrain as part of this wonderful invitation I received from Visioners. So thank you, Khalifa, thank you, Ali, and thank you for the whole group, which has been incredibly gracious to us, a group of three of us who have been going around the country and really admiring what you guys have to offer. I'm going to start by giving you, this is sounding a little strong, I'm going to start by giving you an idea, and I would like you to think about it and then try to respond by asking me questions. If you ask me questions, the lecture is going to be much more interesting, I promise you. If not, I'll just give you my spiel and then, you know, continue. I'm going to show you a progression. I call it evolution in practice. It has many meanings, but the idea about it is that practice evolves and thinking evolves. And the way thinking affects the practice is very interesting. Pretty much, after my studies, and I'm gearing this to our students, if you don't mind, because I think it's an interesting idea to come and address the student body that will be curious about how one starts going in a direction in architecture. And it's actually a very random thing, because there is no formula. There is something that just happens to happen based on many different events. A lot of people call it luck, a lot of people call it being in the right place, a lot of people say that things are supposed to happen and you don't need to understand them. So I'm just going to give you my version. My version is that after graduating from school, I graduated from Pratt Institute in New York, and afterwards graduated from Columbia. In between the two, for 3 years I started to work, and 3 years after I left. The reason I left is because after an intense period of working and producing, I felt that I had not been able to achieve enough, and I'll tell you why. When you look at this diagram that I have put in front of you, you can see a progression of work. Let me go through it, because this was one of the first projects I did, which was a proposal for a hotel, 200-room hotel. I did a proposal for a skyscraper on South Ferry in New York, Lower Manhattan. This was actually part of an ideas competition. These were not realized. We entered a competition for JFK, an airport, and as you can see now, all of these are different. None of them are repetitive. Then we won a competition for the School of Architecture in Minneapolis, Minnesota, University of Minnesota, but for some reason or another, it didn't get realized either. So I'm getting very impatient at this point. We won a competition in Oslo for a newspaper building, and we started working on the building, and the crisis in Oslo, in Norway, came and stopped the job. So at this point, I'm getting very concerned about the fact that things are not happening. Then the office enters a competition and puts me in charge of it for the Chicago Bears Stadium in Chicago, but this is held by the city, not by the client. We win the competition, we awarded the job, and the Bears, meaning the football team, American football team, by the way, they say we're not interested because this is a covered dome. This is not natural grass, and we don't want to play on anything that is not natural grass. Okay, so another job that doesn't go ahead. In a sequence, then we win a competition in Toronto for Royal Trust and CN, and this we start again, and we go into design development, and it stops again. The crisis in Toronto, in Canada, comes, and we have to stop the job. Imagine my frustration. So we win competitions, we start working on them, and we don't get them. Then we get invited to do a project, a hospital project for critical cases in Oslo, and again we win the competition. In fact, we won two competitions. We got first and second prize. We submitted two two entries and we got first and second prize. Again, it doesn't get built. So at this point, I'm getting quite frustrated. Another series of buildings is this time in Ecuador through contacts of mine for a bank, it's commercial buildings. Again, doesn't get built. Finally, we land one project. It's the headquarters for Deloitte & Touche. You know, Deloitte is a very famous accounting firm. We did their headquarters in Connecticut, and this project was the first project I built, won the National AI Award, and started to get me excited again about continuing to work. Shortly after, I get a call from some clients in Ecuador. I grew up in Ecuador, by the way, that had seen the work that I had done, and they asked me to do their house. They were moving themselves. They were moving to Miami, and they were moving one of their banks to Miami, and asked me to do this house based on what they had seen, which is purely unbuilt at this moment. So it was a real vote of confidence on my abilities. So I decided to do it. I said, yes, of course. I go to the office, and I posed the question, and I said, guys, there is a project that I would like to do. This is a house, granted, not a big project, and I would like to do it. And the director of the office said, I'm sorry, we cannot do it, it's too small. And that was the point at which I decided to do something drastic, because I had been working for 6 years nonstop, producing work of very diverse character, and then I had to leave the office. And I said, I'm sorry, I'm leaving the office, I'm gonna do this job. So that's why I have these little dots in there. That was the separation of that 6 years and starting from zero again and starting to work on my own. It's a difficult moment when you have been working on jobs of significance and jobs that challenge you mentally, and then you have to stop all of that. You don't have the backup, and then you have to start on your own. But my proposal to you is that what has happened is that whatever I had started within that office, or most of it, has found its way through, and I have achieved it through my office. And another idea which I want to propose to you is that I was able to do this at a particular time because of where technology was at. The technology was really evolving at the time, so that a small office, because I keep a small office and I don't want to grow it, I don't want to have a 100, 200, 300, 400 person office like the office I was working for. I propose to you that this is possible because of technology. Now with an office of the size of mine, which I keep it between 10 and 20 people, at the moment it's about 14 people, we are able to do any project that we set ourselves to do. So very quickly, I'm gonna show you what happened. The hotel that I started thinking about became a hotel. This is completed. This is in Hanoi. I completed it about a year and a half ago. It's a 450-room hotel. It's part of the Convention Center Hotel campus. It's a very prestigious project that had to be approved by the Minister of Construction because of its location. The exercise that I started with high-rises has been materialized. That project became a high-rise, which now is, basically has become the symbol of Ho Chi Minh City in Vietnam. This is the first project that brought me to Vietnam, then I did the other one. So this was finished about 5 years ago. The airport also found its way through coincidences or competitions, because I had to compete for this job, but I completed one of the concourses in the Miami International Airport. It's a 15 international gates. Was completed about 10 years ago. The School of Architecture I have not done, so I'm still looking for one, as I am for other types of buildings. Now, the interesting thing is that I ended up doing the Chicago Bears Stadium. I left the office in which I first won the competition, and somehow I was able to get that commission, this time with an open-air stadium with natural grass, and I was able to build the stadium for one of the most interesting teams in the NFL. After that, I can show you more buildings which relate to past experiences. I have this in the exhibit on the right, on the left. This is a project that I'm actually starting to work on in Angola. What has happened is that a lot of my work has jumped locations, geographic locations. I haven't, as much as I have not been interested in working on one particular type of building, I have not been able interested in staying within one particular city or one particular country. I enjoy very much to move into different cultures and try to find whatever it is that I can, as I see it, and try to, you know, bring it into the architecture. More projects. This is a commercial project that ended up being an inspiration for another commercial project in Miami. This time is a supermarket. And the project that I started, where I started building, that initial interior became pretty much the inspiration for a second interior where I also won a national AI award with another interior. This was the first completed project in my office, actually. The house came second. I started the house first, but it took longer. So this was the first project. And the house became this piece that you see here. This house, by the way, is the same site, and it's sitting on the same foundation as the old house. So it's taken from a different point of view, but you see this house, it's really the same foundations, but with a very different outlook. And from there it became, you know, a progression of ideas that has culminated in a few houses. I'm not showing them all here because it's no point. But I think that the idea that I'm proposing is that thinking is something that needs to be nurtured, and thinking is something that continues independent of what you do. Even though you are practicing your ideas into one specific type of building, whatever you started continues to evolve, and it evolves through the practice within other projects as well, other scales, other uses, etc. It's a matter of attitude, it's a matter of how you approach design. Now, I hope you have some questions, because I would love to have some questions in order to proceed. And if you do, I will go into specific projects. I'm going to put you on the spot and see who's going to ask the first question.
You.
Yes, you. Whatever comes into your mind, you don't have to do it now, but hopefully you will do it. And if not, somebody else will ask me something, I'm pretty sure. Maggie? Oh, there's a question there. No, sorry, I'll come back to you. Yes, please. Is there a... Which one? This one? This one? What is your question? How does it? In terms of, if I'm understanding your question, is how does it fit with its? Yes. Well, glass has evolved in an incredible way. I mean, glass today is not the same glass as 1960s, 1970s. It has a technological exponential, you know, advance. So I did a project about, it was actually 7 years ago, in Vegas, which is basically a desert condition. And we wanted that project to be, gold certified. And so it was all glass. The client needed it to be all glass because of the image, and he wanted it to be blue glass, which I hated, but I found a way to use it based on the color and so on. And so we proposed a panel, the laminations of glass and frit and all that, which gave us a fantastic U value. So the glass itself now does not need to be cut down as much as before in order to get the same energy performance as before. So in this case, there are two buildings, there are two different uses. The one on your left is the office building, and the one on the right is a hotel. They have two different two different skins. One is more the office building is more just glass. The other one has a ceramic grid and frit on it to reduce the glare into it. Now, what I like about the building, what I think is interesting about the building, because it's placed in Angola, by the way, the name of it is the High Tech Tower. This name will change, but that was what was in the mind of the client. They wanted to introduce a high tech building into the middle of Angola in Luanda. If you have been in Luanda, it's not a place that you can, you know, kind of put together with high tech. But it is evolving very rapidly, and it has a lot of momentum because of the oil production in the country and minerals and so on. But what I wanted to do is to blend the nature of Angola and the high technology aspect of it, and use the nature to disrupt the cleanness of the high technology, the expectation of high technology. So if you see the building, it's actually shifting and bending. So it's breaking that strictness that is implied by the word of high technology, which I really do not think it fits there. So I had to do something to the building to make it respond to the actual site. And the building has this very interesting way of responding to the climate, because it has an outdoors connector. This connector is basically a link between two buildings of different programs with a common program, which is where you put together the amenities of the hotel, which can also be used by the office building. And so what that link has is a pool, and it has exterior areas, and also has the spa, and it has actually two levels, which you have exterior office space, and it connects to a very unique private offices as well. So it's a common link that is used to bring together the two without having to go inside, to go down and back up again. And another interesting part of it is the podium, which is really an open podium. It's not a mall. It's not an enclosed mall. Because I didn't want to produce another mall, because I'm the way I explained to the client, I'm tired of all to finding the same type of brands in every single city, and I didn't want to produce another mall where they could have the same international brands again and again and again, because you see them in the airport as soon as you arrive. So I didn't really want to encourage that kind of commercialization of it. As out of the inspiration of that, the client became interested in having only local brands and having a place where you could foster the success of these brands by encouraging them to exhibit, produce, educate themselves, etc. And he started the idea of doing an incubator, actually, out of that conversation, where he proposes to educate people and also help them in growing the brand that they propose. So if they demonstrate enough interest on how the brand is produced, they will actually help them with the marketing and with the production of the brand, etc. So it became a more local, more local commercial part of the building, as opposed to another mall. Yes. Yes. That's an interesting question. If you remember, I mentioned this house. This is a house that was not the first house, but I think it was the second house I did. I've done very few, maybe three or four, actually four. But this house was very special to me because it was done for very dear friends of mine, artists, with enough means to do a very beautiful house, but they found a very, very calm piece of land that had a fantastic view over the valley. And it has a drop, but they didn't want me to cantilever the whole house into it. They didn't want to go against the hill. They wanted to hug the hill and to get a feeling of levitation. That's how they put it. They wanted to levitate over the land. So what I did with it is to basically hug the hill, but extend the arms. The two arms actually extended and went past. They went past the hill. You can see here. right? So the result was a pool, and I'm trying to get to it. I'm sorry that I'm not seeing it. I have to put my glasses again. A pool that actually continued past the hill, so that you, when you went to the end of the pool, you were, without knowing it, you were floating in air. And it became a very interesting scenario. I'm trying to find it, actually. Here we go. You can see how the pool itself goes from the ground and leaves the ground, and you can see it on the picture on the right. The building simply takes off. Now, that became the first pool I did that was floating, and I really enjoyed the whole idea of swimming in the air. To me, it became almost a meditation. And I did this because the two of them, the two owners, really enjoyed swimming in the morning. And I thought that what could be more beautiful than to just float, to let them actually swim, do their exercise, and at the end simply rest and float in the air. So this idea was then picked up by another client of mine when I actually presented the work that I was doing. I was asked to go to Singapore for a possible job. So I flew to Singapore and I talked to the owners, and as I explained to them what I had done with this house, the gentleman was very intrigued, and he asked me if I would consider doing a series of houses in the sky so that it could become a building. So transform that house now into a vertical building. Something which was so horizontal, now take it into the air and make it vertical and produce some of these homes between the condominiums. So not all of them are the same. So as a consequence, we ended up getting these condominiums, these homes within the building which have pools. This was the result. We had a building which was very sculpted, very chiseled, very elongated, and had these arms that actually started to leave the building and produce that same feeling of floating, that feeling that you are actually free of the building as you swim into the sky. And this is something that I find extremely interesting, extremely fascinating, because it provides new opportunities within high rises. I think high rises sometimes get too constrained by their own structures. I think it's constrained by the fear that a structure has to be very, very, very minimal and very restrained and very, what do you call it? A 100% usable, let's put it that way. But what is missing is that all of this makes the high rise hermetic or controlled, and it lacks freedom. If you look at most high rises, they are very tight. They're almost like statues. They don't move. They don't have that sense of movement. Even light doesn't make them move, because when you see a lower structure or a horizontal structure, you see how they change with light hitting them, because they have the freedom of hugging the ground. But when you go vertical, most, I'm not saying all of them, but most high rises just become very, very, very tight, very compressed, very stiff. And I think that introducing this kind of vocabulary into a building, it starts to relax that. It starts to make the building much more dynamic and start to relate more to its different elements in the site. These are the elevations, for instance, of that building. You can see that they are not the same at all. What we did is that we started on the bottom, first by lifting. If you look at where my arrow is here, we lifted the first apartments from the ground, because in order not to have the noise of the ground and not to have that eye contact with the ground, we lifted it to the sixth floor. So we started on the sixth floor, and then we started to carve, you know, outdoor spaces within the building. These are actually zoning requirements within Singapore, which I took full advantage of. And then I took that knowledge into buildings that I'm doing in Miami, where there is no requirement for outdoor spaces, but I find them so fascinating that I'm actually injecting them into the buildings and actually breaking that monotony of floors. But in this case, we had those open spaces, and we had pools, and we ended up with actual four pools into this building. The first half has two apartments per floor, And then the upper portion has only one apartment per floor, so you can see the core is being expressed on the outside. So I'm going to just show you how this floor plate started to change. That was the two apartments per floor, which we continue, but they start to change because of the movement of the building. This is one of the open areas, the break, the outdoor space, and then the building shifts to one side where the views are, and then the core gets exposed, and it continues to evolve as it goes up. One of the pools in there on the side, and it goes back to itself. And then you go up to the top where you actually have, you know, this pool which is on top on the roof, which is expands outside of the building. And I think that's very important. You see the other pool going on the other side. Now, all of this happens within the natural setbacks of the site. There is nothing that is violating any rules. This is all possibilities within the rules. It's all about how you interpret the rules. So instead of getting afraid of the rules, you start to interpret them in a way that contributes to the architecture. So I don't know if I'm getting across to what I'm trying to say, but there are a lot of possibilities presented. You just have to look at them and find them. You have to interpret things in a way that makes the building positive. And I think I'm dealing with different types of buildings at the same time. I'm dealing with low rises, I'm dealing with high rises, I'm dealing with different types of building, like buildings with holes in the middle, like stadiums, buildings which are completely occupied. And that makes me think differently in terms of how I'm going to approach the next project. And I think that's very valuable. So it's interesting to expand your mind and not just think of one way of doing things. Somebody else? Yes? Well, as you know, buildings are not a product of the architect himself or herself. This is not how it happens. Building is a collaboration between a client and an architect, unless you are your own client, which is possible. But at that point, it's a conversation between two sides, and you have to honor that. What that means is that some of the projects will become more, let's call them, responsible than others, or more advanced than others. So what happens is that during that conversation, you start to bring up possibilities to your client, and your client starts to bring possibilities to you. You have to analyze budgets, you have to analyze, you know, where technology is at, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Now, technology is changing. So this need for radical changes into a building to respond to global warming is not necessarily true. What needs to happen is an understanding of the technology, where it's at, and how to adapt it in order to respond to the problem. So there are some very basic things you can do. You can raise the building because the water is raising. I'm not trying to diminish the situation here, which is really, really critical. But the truth is, water is rising. Water levels are rising. So now, as a response to that, planners and architects are planning to raise the buildings, and I've done it, and I've done it actually more than needed, sometimes for reasons that have nothing to do with architecture, such as insurance. Insurance companies will not insure a building if it doesn't follow certain rules, and that makes life much more difficult for your client. So instead of being stubborn about how it should be, you think about finding a way to make that work for you. So lifting the building, not in this case that I showed you, but lifting the building sometimes can be very, very interesting. So you lift it, and then you take all the mechanical systems out of the ground, because now it has been proven that it's necessary to do that, et cetera, et cetera. So there are many ways of responding to all these crises and making it respond, but also technology is responding as well. For instance, glass, there are certain types of glass now which absorb energy. So instead of the glass being seen as always wasteful, it can also gather energy, transfer it back into the building and help it, you know, with the functioning of the building. You have a very good example here on the World Trade Center with the turbines. Of course, the more wind, the better, but you know, turbines can be used to generate electricity. Now there's new technologies which are proposing to bring batteries, just like the hybrid cars, bringing batteries into buildings. They are starting with homes where you actually take the energy produced by solar energy or wind energy, and instead of giving it back to the grid when you don't need it, you store it, so you don't need the energy from the grid. That's actually moving towards a self-sustainable type of architecture. There are other technologies which I learned very recently about, certain ways of capturing electricity which is floating around us. So there is a lot that is happening in the next few years that is going to change the way we see buildings, and they are all going towards buildings becoming self-sustainable. Yeah? Yes.
So I'd like to know what other examples and what other buildings have been inspired by local cultures.
Yes, I'll show you the building in. This is the building in Ho Chi Minh City. It's a high rise. It's a tall building, and the most notable part of it is that it has a helipad. It's basically a platform. It's almost like a pedal, which is opened up to receive you. What it does, it receives helicopters. So it's really there to receive a helicopter at the 55th floor. And it goes into, you know, a club, and then it goes into executive offices, or you go down into the other offices. This has been finished. This is the actual platform. It's the structure of it. It's all based on cantilevered steel that anchors back to the core. With that in mind, I'm just going to tell you that because it's not that by doing what I'm going to show you, you have to ignore other parts. You have to find a way to do them. But this building was inspired, if you want to put it that way, by the lotus flower bud, which means it's not the flower itself, it's not fully opened. It's a moment in nature where a flower is about to blossom. And that, I wanted to capture that as the moment in which Vietnam was, when I was hired to do this building. I felt Vietnam was in a situation where it was about to blossom, but it had not yet. This was the first high rise in Vietnam. I was hired to do the first high rise. There were no codes to do it. They had never done a building taller than, I think it was 25 stories. So we had to bring consultants to work with the city to write the code, to change the code to their needs, especially the fire needs, etc. But the interesting part here was that we needed a symbol, because this was gonna, by request of my client, who was a very, very proud national, he wanted a building that would inspire, you know, his country, the youth of his country, because if you think about Vietnam right now has about, I think it's 80% of its population under 25 years old or something like that. It's a tremendous amount of resource, human resource. So he insisted that the first high-rise had to be built by a Vietnamese, not by an international company. He didn't want to wait for the foreign companies to come and build in Vietnam. He wanted to be the first one to build something of significance, because he knew that would change the character of the people in the country, the people in the city, and I think it has done it. So this has become now the symbol of Ho Chi Minh City, which is part of the skyline, but it's also a building which is very unusual. It's not something you see everywhere. So it has a certain personality that adapts to the country. The way we made it adapt to the country was to relate it to a symbol. We found their national flower, and we found the positive, you know, three-dimensional aspects of that bud as opposed to the flower. Because the flower would have been too horizontal and not the right symbol for a high rise. So what we did is, if you can see here, we took the bud and we elongated it, because a high rise is an elongation of a building. It's not necessarily you know, doesn't have to be taken so literally. So we injected that sense of elongation going towards the sky, and we learned from it that the building could actually expand and then go back into the air. Point up to the sky in an elongated way, and that's what we did. And then we took all these elements of peeling leaves and brought them into the building, and then we took the different stages at which the flower starts to open, and we took that moment of the first flower opening to signify the moment where the helipad becomes an element. And then we materialized that, we made it into a physical thing. And I already showed you how it happened, because it's all based on structures that cantilever and go back to the core. Did that answer it? In the case of the building in Angola, this building is based on again the movement within the nature. Angola is actually a very beautiful nature that is not very well known, but I started to do a lot of research into that, and it has a lot of texture. So I didn't want the buildings to be clean and precise. I wanted the buildings to have this ruggedness to them. And I based it on a formation, rock formation. I don't have it here to show you, but it was based on a rock formation which is very, very famous in the country. It was, so I wanted to talk about the solidity of it. And to talk about solidity, you talk about how it has sustained, you know, or how it sustains nature. And that's by shifting and adapting. And that's really what strength is an adaptation. So we made this building adapt to the movement and to bend and to connect, as opposed to being a very clean, precise, symmetrical building. I didn't believe in the symmetry here, because nothing around the site has an implied symmetry. Anybody else? Yes. For what? The airport. Yes, that's a very. To me, the rules are rules, and rules should not dictate what the project is. I mean, if you cannot comply with the rules, you shouldn't be doing the project. So the basic thing you do is understand the rules to the point that you can interpret them. If your project is controlled by the rules, then it's not free to become architecture. It's just a building. When we were actually hired to do this building, which was a result of I don't know how many firms competed for it, but a lot of them, and it was just we kept getting through the motions until we were selected to do it. It's this part of Miami International Airport. It's a concourse. It has 15 international gates, full of regulations, full of diagrams, and all of them very square, very rectangular, and very much one after the other. No? So what we did with it, let me see if I can find it here, is we felt that what they were giving us was very constrained. It was a rectangle, and it was very oppressive because of the length, the proportion of the length to the width and the height of the building was wrong. And I felt that was not a good way to receive people into the country, because this is international flights coming in. I felt that we had to infuse air into this building. So the whole premise was to infuse air like a balloon and make the structure change and grow. So what we did to it, it was actually take that rectangle that you can see here, and we started to blow it up. And as you see, the walls are actually inclined. They're not straight. There was a reason for that. Is the distance from the nose of the building to the from nose of the airplane to the building had to be a certain dimension. Very naive way of thinking. So at the beginning, everybody was telling us, no, you cannot incline anything because it has to be X, let's call it 50 feet, right? It had to be 50 feet. So what we did is we drew a circle out of the 50 feet and showed them how we could incline it and not violate the rule. At that point, they had nothing to say. So we inclined the walls, and we went up, and then we curved it. And as we kept going further into the building kept growing, and then we had the tower in it. But it was an interesting thing that then we had to resolve technically. So you cannot produce every single piece of structure differently because you want your building to change, right? If you want a building to breathe, and need to expand like the thorax, you want it to breathe, to go up and then go down, that means you can take the computer and blow up each of the structures by 15%, 15%, and then go back 15%. But then that means you have to make them, you have to produce them. And in production, economics dictate repetition. So what we needed to do is to control those pieces that joined the elements and make those pieces change. So those are these red pieces here. So what happens is that these red pieces, which are very small compared to the whole structure, they increase and contract, and the rest of the building, which are the structural arches and structural trusses, are repetitive, and they go through. But what happens is that, you know, you get this kind of, sorry, let me see if I can find you a better one. Yeah, the interior actually expands and contracts, but I'm trying to show you a different one. I think the best one I have is this one, which shows how the building really, you know, expands. The beauty of it is when you come in, you feel it. You're not restricted by this very rectangular endless box. But as you walk, the structure actually changes with you. Sorry. Now it's your turn. Yeah, can you give her the microphone? That's good. It's hard to answer, but I think that as you go through, I think the first project you do, you have such an anxiety inside of yourself that you have to put everything you know out there, and that I did in the first house. I did is actually every single bolt was designed. I was lucky enough to have a client that was interested in me doing that, but I was able to custom make almost everything. But it was so difficult to make that I had to basically move myself from New York to Miami and build it myself with the contractors, because it was a very, very, very intricate house. I cannot do that with every project, of course. And also, once you release that energy, it becomes easier to concentrate on other things. What you concentrate on and what you should concentrate on is understanding, first of all, what it is that you're looking at, and doing a lot of research until whatever you are receiving in terms of information, it starts to inspire a response. So I think that the evolution that myself or my office has gone through as we have done more and more projects is to, instead of pushing out something that we have inside, we are now assimilating information before we put it out. So the person and the office becomes a filter, maybe. So you bring in information almost randomly, but it's an educated collection of information, and then as you process it, then you put it out. So like the architect, the firm, the person becomes a filter that edits the information that comes in. I don't know if I answered your question. Okay. Anybody else? If not, I think it's a good time to stop. Okay. Well, thank you very much.
I just wanted to give a quick word if you mind, Carlos, before we end. Earlier today, I was having